It's Martin Luther King Day, Monday, January 17th. Plus, on the Red, White, and View, New York Senator Kirsten Gillibrand just got back from Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords' bedside, and she's telling you how she's recovering and her problem with Sarah Palin's statement on the tragedy in Tucson.
Well, right now we're going to come back with what a transition with a woman who is very much respected. That is Senator Kirsten Gillibrand, and she was with a Representative Gifford when the congresswoman opened her eyes. So we want to talk to her. We'll be right back.
We love her.
Clinton was appointed Secretary of State. Her Senate seat was filled by Kirsten Gillibrand, who quickly distinguished herself. She was instrumental in passing the 9/11 First Responders Bill and repealing the military's Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy. Been reading more about it recently because her personal life was touched deeply by the recent tragedy in Tucson. And the senator just left the bedside of her dear friend, Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords. Please welcome the junior senator of New York, Kirsten Gillibrand. I should also mention in passing that you are the mother of a 7-year-old and a 2-year-old, whom you're bringing up perfectly, right?
Well, yes, they're wonderful children. And Henry's the 2-year-old and Theo is the 7-year-old. And they're... love trains, they love trucks, anything with wheels, that's...
Do you feel like, I mean, traveling back and forth to the district, I mean, is that impossible to just keep on top of their schedules and everything? How do you...
Well, we try to keep it as normal as possible, so my schedule is a little different during the week. Sure. I really try to bring them to school every morning, pick them up in the evening, read them their books, give them their baths, and put them to bed. So
Let's talk about the Congresswoman, because you were with her when she opened her eyes for the first time. Tell us about that, and also bring us up to date. How is she doing?
Well, she's doing great, and she makes so much progress every day. I just talked to her husband, Mark, a couple nights ago, and she's really doing wonderful. And I think her courage and her strength is really inspiring the whole country.
Did she recognize her husband yet?
Yes, absolutely. She understands what's going on around her. When we were there in the hospital room, we were there with her mother, her father, her husband, Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz, Speaker Pelosi, and she knew what was going on. She was holding my hand, and we were talking to her.
She knew you were there.
She did, and she was squeezing when we were talking about the fun things we wanted to do as soon as she got better. Mm-hmm. And you know, when she heard our voices, and we were there telling about what you know, and I told her that she was inspiring the world with her strength, and I wanted to give her the understanding that her courage mattered. And
how do you know she knew?
Because she squeezed my hand every time I said something positive and wonderful about her. She could respond, and so
she
when
just
we
can't speak.
Not yet, but she will. Yeah,
I know.
And we just have to keep praying. When I was speaking to her, she began to flutter her eyes, and that's what her husband nearly leaped across the bed, and he just looked at her and said, Gabby, open your eyes, open your eyes. And then she opened her eyes, and then he said, can you see me? And he literally was just willing her across the finish line. He was just saying, you know, his love for her is just extraordinary, and that's what makes them such a beautiful couple, because they love each other so much. And he's incredible. I mean, he's an astronaut. He's going to lead the next space shuttle. He's not only brilliant and interesting, but he truly loves Gabby, and that love was so ever-present in that room.
It's so important to recovery. I mean, we hear so many stories like that. You know, this was a tricky incident because it became incredibly politicized and controversial. Last week, Sarah Palin defended herself against the false accusations linking her somehow to the Tucson killer. She used the term anti-Semitic slur, blood libel. What are your thoughts on her comments? I mean, certainly she had a right to say defend herself, but should she have gone that far?
Well, I don't think the comments were helpful, and I think they were inappropriate, but that being said, this is a call to action for all of us as leaders, for her, for me, for everyone who represents different constituents in America. We have to be better than we are. And I loved what President Obama said in his speech in Tucson. He said, we have to live up to the aspirations, the expectations of our children.
Absolutely.
And he used Christina Green's life as a metaphor for all of our nation's children. And I think that was so important. I think so it's an opportunity for all of us to bring each other together so we can get to the tough issues.
I understand that at the State of the Union address, you are pushing for bipartisan seating.
Yes.
So that, you know, usually you have the Republicans on one side and the Democrats on the other.
Fantastic idea.
And it's a visual cue for bipartisanship. Are they going to go for it, do you think?
Yes. Many of us, we're just going to do it. We're just going to go down and sit where we want to sit.
On your side.
We're just going to do it.
my seat. Get out of my seat.
There's no seats. First of all, everyone can sit where they want. It's just tradition.
Democrats are going to sit in the Republican
seat. So we're just going to go down the aisle, and instead of me going left, I'm going to go right. Instead of them going right, they're going to go left. So a lot of us are going to do it. And it's just an image. It's a symbol of what is possible. And, you know, for all the things we've been working on, bipartisanship really does matter. When we were able to finally get the 9/11 health bill done, that was because it was a bipartisan effort. Don't ask, don't tell.
You know what? Bipartisan effort. We're still going to have voices, radical voices from the left and the right. Yeah. That doesn't mean that Congress has to be like that.
That's what the American
people don't want that. Like, we can shoot our mouths off in the press. That's not your job, in my opinion. American people want results.
Exactly.
So get to work, all of you out there.
Exactly.
Yeah, let Sarah Palin say what she wants.
Run for office.
I would like to one of these days. Okay. I'm too old.
I'll help you. You are not too old.
Well, speaking of elections, in 2012, I know that you're planning on running, again, re-election. Yeah. What are your main issues?
Well, we have to work on the economy. The biggest issue right now, when I travel in New York, every family I talk to, every small business owner, people are struggling. And we have a 10% unemployment rate. And that means that far more people are out of work. Because when the real unemployment rate's at 10%, it means, when the stated unemployment's at 10%, real unemployment's higher. Yeah. You're talking about families who can't, you know, do the things they need to do for their children, whether it's education or health care. So we have to create those jobs. We've got to get money into small businesses, tax cuts for small businesses. That's the number one issue. But there's other issues. I also want to work on marriage equality. I want to make sure that everyone in this country can be married to the people they love.
I want to change it up a little bit. November, Vogue did a feature issue on you. They did a spread. You looked fantastic.
I
have to say, did it bother you at all when Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid said you were the hottest member in Congress?
No.
Did it bother you?
He's the hottest member in Congress.
He was trying to be sweet. He was trying to be nice and funny, actually. But Harry Reid's an extraordinary man, and he really helped in both the 9/11 bill and Don't Ask, Don't Tell. Mm-hmm. In the 9/11 bill, he helped bring the senior Republicans to the room to negotiate, to bring us over the finish line, as did Senator Schumer. He was an extraordinary closer in that issue. And on Don't Ask, Don't Tell, it was Harry Reid who very early on wrote a letter to the president and said, we want you to repeal Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And that really set us up for the president put it in his State of Union address. It allowed for, Chairman Levin agreed immediately to hold a hearing. And so we were able to create the testimony and the record to repeal that very corrosive policy.
But, looking at you, you are pretty hot. But also, and this is coming from
Leslie,
a
woman. So are you. And so are you.
Lesbian
but
alerts.
Also, but also, everyone, people can see why you are filling the Senate, the Secretary of State. Filling the Secretary of State seat, and why you are running it. You and I go back a long way now, and I'm very proud of you.
Barbara was one of the nicest people to me. When I was first appointed, she invited me to her home, and she had this beautiful dinner party of all these fabulous friends of hers, and it was one of the kindest, sweetest things anybody did at that time, when most people had no idea.
So I'm totally responsible for her. If you're a Republican, don't
put
that on me. Our thanks to Senator Kirsten Gillibrand. Thank you for being with us today. Our prayers are with your colleague.
Yeah, thank you. Please all pray for her.
With a very controversial first morning.
To Hillary Clinton, keep fighting for us.
TeamHillaryClinton.com.